गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी हैव आवर स्पीकर सीए निखिल जी. इज अ क्वालिफाइड चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट पजेसिंग 8 years ऑफ पोस्ट क्वालिफिकेशन एक्सपीरियंस इन इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स, वेट, कॉर्पोरेट फाइनेंस, बिजनेस ऑपरेशन, ट्रेजरी, लाइसेंसिंग विद द बैंक एंड फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशन एंड मेनी मोर. एट प्रेजेंट ही इज अ प्रैक्टिसिंग चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट सर्विंग क्लाइंट्स इन जयपुर, दिल्ली. His core area of working is taxation, advisory, compliance, litigation, support, drafting to show cause notice and reporting clients before department in Indian GST and UAE VAT. Further, he is keen to collaborate with startup to help them grow and set up a robust financial and account F&A department and tax function to ensure a structure and compliant business process. He has been closely work on GST implementation in India and UAE VAT. Implementation in particular, impact analysis, regulatory support, implementation support, IT support, tax advisory and compliances. He is also a faculty member of ICAI, regularly speak at forums and seminars on various topics of GST. He is also a keen writer and his articles have been published in prominent tax journals and websites like Service Tax Review, Tax India Online, Tax Guru, CA Club India. Earlier, he had a stint in Avadha Group, Gautam Thapar Group and JP Group, wherein he was working with CEO, Business Head and President Finance. He will share his details with you, contact numbers. In case if you have any difficulty, you can directly contact him. We will add in him our WhatsApp group also for query solving. Before we start the session, I would like to inform you that tomorrow morning we have a session on capital gain issues, critical issues in the capital gain, tomorrow 11 o'clock. In the evening we have a session on financial implication on financial of COVID in the financial statement, what will be the implication of the COVID in the financial statement, index and other related changes or implication basically, by regional council member CA Chintan Patel. So take the maximum advantage of that. And we have already launched second series also on this GST webinar. So kindly enroll or also share with your friends and other colleagues. With this, would like to hand over charge to Nikhil ji. Nikhil ji, please take the charge for today's session.
Thank you very much, Virag ji, for introducing me, and thank you very much, and I welcome everyone to today's webinar, the day 5.
It's our proud privilege to have a session to listen from you, sir.
Right. So I'm also thankful to Abhishek ji for providing me this opportunity to share my views. So today we will be discussing about GST returns and compliances. So what is the first thing which comes to your mind when we talk about GST returns? First thing is these are very common, you know, routine business transactions and business compliances which we face, and we are very habitual of it, doing it on a monthly basis or a quarterly basis. But today we'll try to look at in some different perspective. We will link it from a legal aspects and also understand the intention and reasoning behind so many compliances. So what all we'll be covering today, why so many compliances in GST or maybe erstwhile tax regimes, relevance of these compliances, what would be the consequences if we do not follow and we do not comply with the provisions of the GST law, then we will have an overview of all returns and statements in GST. So primarily we have two returns, GSTR 1 and GSTR 3B, which we all are aware and mostly we file. But there are a couple of other compliances and returns depending on the special circumstances and natures and circumstances and business scenarios that we will discuss. We will touch upon annual return and audits and what are the key points which we should keep in mind while doing audit for 2018 and 19. As we already completed for 2017 and 18. Then we'll be discussing about recent relaxations in compliances under GST And I, if the time allows, I'll also brief about new returns regime. So first of all, why so many compliances we see? So we are in a self-assessment regime, unlike in VAT, although we used to, you know, file returns on a regular basis and also file a annual returns. But in most of these states, we used to have a annual assessments, right, in every financial year. But in GST, or if you talk about central excise and service tax concept, so what they say, the government says that we allow you, you self-assess your taxes, you list down your purchases, you list down your sales and assess your tax liability and intimate us with the notified returns and compliances. So now, when there is no automatic compliances or checks and balances every often, so the point is, we will not have annual assessments or annual audits, or the government or departments will not come to us every 2 months or every single month that what you are exactly doing, because we are under a self-assessment regime. So in return, they expect that we report our business transactions, what all we are doing. So in current scenario, we do not have any yearly assessments. And why government needs to know about our business transactions? Because to ensure that we are complying with the laws, whatever provisions are there in the laws, and we are not claiming or we are not misusing the provisions of the law. And suppose input tax credit is the live example. We have seen a lot of frauds wherein fake ITC cases have come up in last 3 years of implementation. So government needs to ensure that you are complying with the law. And sometimes various information is also asked for statistical and policy making purposes, so that they can, you know, improvise and give you and, you know, act as a proactive role in policy making and address the trade and industry issues. And we all know that GST is not only a central concept, it's also a state. Every state is also a part of the machinery. Every state has its own GST law, which is more or less same to central GST law. But every state has its own set of revenues, has its own set of machinery. For this, they also need a revenue. So on, also for the purpose of distribution of revenue among the different states, we, the government wants to know what all you are paying, whether you are paying CGST, SGST or IGST. Then we have different compliances for the different taxpayers. What I always feel that in India, we do not take compliances very seriously. We take it very lightly. For us, sir, कोई बात नहीं, अभी एक बार फाइल कर देते हैं, देख लेंगे, असेसमेंट के टाइम देख लेंगे, ऑडिट के टाइम देख लेंगे, देख लिया जाएगा एट द फिजिक. बट नाउ आई जस्ट वांट टू टेल यू दैट वी आर इनटू द डिजिटल एरा, एंड इवन गवर्नमेंट इज यूजिंग लॉट ऑफ एडवांस टूल्स एंड आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस, यू नो, टू कलेक्ट डिफरेंट इंफॉर्मेशन फ्रॉम डिफरेंट सोर्सेज. एंड इन टाइम्स टू कम वी विल बी फेसिंग लॉट ऑफ, यू नो, ऑटो जनरेशन ऑफ नोटिसेस एंड ऑर्डर्स एंड डिफरेंट compliances. And for the first time, everyone is filing their return under a single nationwide portal, which we call it GST portal. Earlier we used to have a different portals for different states, as well as different portals for different tax regime, like central excise, service tax, at different portals. So now the significance of compliances have increased manifold. Why? Because whatever information you are reporting, it is being gathered in a structured manner, and proper reconciliation and different tools and facilities are being provided to the revenue officers, so that they can call out the relevant information. They can, you know, with the use of artificial intelligence, they can come to know about the business trend. Suppose a taxpayer is reporting a business transaction of rupees 100 in a month, let's say April 20. In May, he is reporting nil transaction. In June, he is reporting 1,000. So now you can see the trend. So by these all advanced tools which are there, so they can also look at the business trends. Then we have invoice-wise matching tool, which provides and gives the insight to the government How about the ITC claims which everyone is doing? Increased interlinking between income tax and GST. So whatever information you are providing in your GST returns. So now we also have a column in income tax returns where is we have to disclose the turnover of GST under the income tax. So you can see the interlinking. So it's not that the government did not have the data. Government had the data, but it was scattered everywhere. Now it is completely centralized under the GST portal. So they have better tools and mechanisms to give the impetus to it. So, and they also doing collection of different information on different sources, be it from tolls, e-way bills, e-invoices. Then we are also looking at new returns. So e-invoicing will definitely be a game changer in terms of compliances. And there is no mechanism for revision in returns like in GSTR 3B. We do not have a mechanism. We cannot revise the GSTR 3B which we are filing for a particular month. We have to adjust the taxes in a next particular month. And return data is a base data to decide the criteria. So obviously, government is also has a role to play. The revenue officers, they also do audits on a selective basis. So selective basis is mostly either the risk management, risk criteria, or based on the industry, or based on the turnover criteria. So we should be aware what all information we should submit to the department in a structured manner to avoid any issues or to avoid any trouble in future for us. Because what happens, normally there are various clients, or you can say there are various trade and industry. So sometimes they ask, sir, so let's say we take an example of an input tax credit. We all are aware about the section 17, subsection 5, which take a lot of our time, that how much credit is allowed, and there are a lot of credits which are disallowed. So substantially, sometimes client says, sir, if we claim this credit, to kya hoga? What will be the risk? So the basic question which comes up, sir, what will happen? Mereko kaun pakdega? How the government will come to know that maine jo credit liye wo galat claim kari hai? Yeah, how the government will come to know? Mere paas to invoice aa chuka hai, par maine koi services ya goods avail nahi kiye. Based on invoice I have, maine credit claim kar li. GSTR 3B mein koi mechanism nahi hai. So what about that? So I think some participants cannot see the PPT. So is there any issue, or Virajji, can you see it? Because PPT is there. I will reshare the screen. I hope that you are able to see it now. Yeah, so moving forward, so we were taking that example. So that's why we have to look at from different perspective now in coming in GST, because it's a digital era, importance of compliances. And you please be rest assured that the consequences of non-compliances are very high, and government has given immense power to different officers at different stages and different levels to give you a lot of troubles. If you are doing any undervaluation, so you can have a differential tax liability. Even they have a power to block your input tax credit. The recently new rule which has come up, 86A, wherein the commissioner has a power, they can even block an input tax credit on certain specified circumstances. There is a, you know, unconditional power to any officer that he can issue a summon to you under section 70, and you have to appear before the officer or give your statements. And department has also a power to best judge your assessment on best judgment basis or on different summary assessment. So if you are not taking any registration and still you have already crossed your 40 lakhs limit in case of goods, or 20 lakhs in case of services, or like you have not paid your taxes since long, from last 6 months, or you have not filed your returns, so definitely they have power to cancel your registration. So cancellation of registration is kind of such thing, it, you know, gives a temporary halt to your business transaction. You cannot do a business without GST registration, right? Because in many corporates you will see that for any vendor registration or for empanelment, they want that you should be registered in GST. Everyone wants to do business only with the registered vendors so that they can keep a check on them. Then in case of any delayed payment of tax, you have to pay interest at the rate of 18%. For delayed filing of returns, you have late fees, which is up to 100 rupees per day. Then in certain scenarios where if you are not paying any tax willfully, or you have claimed any input tax credit fraudulently, then government has a power to impose a penalty up to 100% of the tax which you are evading. And even if you are not paying after getting the confirmed orders or adjudication, when your demand has been confirmed, then they have a power to attach your bank accounts also. Arrest provisions are also there, and they also have non-billable offenses. Then we have some general penalties for small compliances. So you can see the machinery that there are various consequences of non-compliance. Right. So now let's look at the returns. What are all returns in GST? First, we will look at the basic return structure, which I will call it a return cycle. A return cycle kab complete hota hai. So you start with GSTR1. So whenever you are doing any business transaction, so you will have any sales. So let's say you list down your sales for a month, that you have to file your GSTR1 either on a quarterly basis or on a monthly basis, depending on the turnover criteria. And they have a different due dates. For monthly, you have to file your return by 11th of the next month. So now you will see the section. The section says, section 37 about the GSTR1, it says that the due date has to be 10th of the next month. But by notification, because the power has been given to the commissioner to extend the due date, by notification, they are issuing notifications for every month separately. So recently they've issued notifications up to September 2020, for which the GSTR1 monthly return due date is 11th of next month, and for quarterly it is 30th of the next month following the quarter. So once you upload your invoices in GSTR1, so your recipient, so let's say I am a recipient, I'll be getting those invoices, whatever purchases I've made from my vendor, under GSTR2A, it will be reflected. Now GSTR2A, so earlier when GST implementation started from 1st of July 2017, the ideal structure was GSTR1, GSTR2 and GSTR3, wherein you had a facility that in GSTR2, what you will do, you will be getting all the invoices from your vendors, and you will have a facility to tick mark, to take an action on all those invoices. But that, unfortunately, that system couldn't work because of the portal limitations or because of the invoice-wise matching tool on Pan India level. So what they did, they introduced a temporary return, we call it GSTR3B, and GSTR2 was kept on hold, and only GSTR2 is there where you can have a view facility. Even though it is only a view facility, but the department is taking it very seriously. And even when we talk about claims of our input tax credit, recently we had a rule 36 sub rule 4 from 9th of October 2019, where firstly the capping of the input tax credit which you can claim was 20%, which was increased to reduced to 10% from 1st of January 2020. And again, the refund provisions or refund claims are also being linked with GSTR2A. So GSTR2 is a very relevant or very important tool. We have to make sure that our vendors are regularly filing their returns so that we can see our invoices under GSTR2A. Now, then based on this, what you do, you file a GSTR3B, which is a temporary return. So now this temporary return, you can see, is still continuing for last 3 years. And even when it was introduced earlier, so it was not a return under section 39. So if you are aware about the judgment of Gujarat High Court in case of AAP and company, wherein they have held that GSTR3B is not a return. So once it is not a return, there cannot be any late fee. But by way of a retrospective amendment, they have nullified that High Court judgment. And by retrospective amendment from 1st of July 2017, they have made changes in the rules. And now this GSTAR 3B is also a return under Section 39, Subsection 1, which was initially made for GSTAR 3. But there is a drawback and there is a flaw in GSTAR 3B. That GSTAR 3B is only a consolidated summary. It does not have any linkage or any interlinking either with GSTAR 2A or with GSTAR 1. And this is the issue which we faced during GST audits while filing 994, 17, 18. So what happened? Most of the clients were not aware what all data which they reported or uploaded in GSTAR 3B. Because they did not maintain in a proper manner the backup or basis of the supplies which they have reported in GSTAR 3B. So there was a complete mess up. We could not reconcile values in what was there in GSTAR 1, what was there in GSTAR 3B, and books of accounts. Right. Then after all this, what government says, so chalo, jo aapne jo bhi file kar diya GSTAR 1, GSTAR 3B mein, अब आप उसका एक कंसोलिडेटेड इंफॉर्मेशन जीएसटी 9 में फाइल करते हैं. तो दैट्स हाउ दिस इज द कंप्लीट रिटर्न साइकिल. बाय दिस द रेवेन्यू ऑफिसर गेट द एंटायर कंप्लीट स्कीमा एंड कंप्लीट इंफॉर्मेशन ऑन योर बिजनेस प्रोफाइल एंड देन दे विल स्टार्ट डूइंग द ऑडिट्स. एंड फॉर 17-18 आफ्टर द कंप्लीशन ऑफ 17-18 रिटर्न साइकिल इन 31st जनवरी 2020 द ऑडिट्स बाय डिपार्टमेंट हैज ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड बट इट हैज बीन अगेन you know delayed because of this COVID-19. This is the basic framework of GST. And if you talk about GSTAR 3B, so we have different due dates for different states, definitely subject to a turnover criteria which we'll be discussing in detail. So now if we first talk about GSTAR 1, so we can split into two parts. Having aggregate turnover, now when I talk about aggregate turnover, it means aggregate turnover for the Pan India. If you have a GST registration in more than one state, so the entire turnover on Pan India basis will be counted here. So if you have aggregate turnover up to 1.5 crores, which government says you are a small taxpayer, we give you an option ki aap quarterly return bhi file kar sakte hain. Aur us case mein you can file your return by 30th of the next month. And if you having an aggregate turnover more than 1.5 crores, us case mein aapko mandatorily monthly return file karna hai by 11th of the next month. And here I would like to highlight one rule that section 37. So what happens, suppose let's talk about 1920. There is a one transaction of April 19, one invoice, which by mistake I could not report in GSTAR 1 till now. So can I actually report it now? So now again, I will also give you one more aspect here. So now there are three kind of legal machinery in my opinion. Legally, so one, we have GST Act, which provides the different provisions of the law. Now then second, we have GST rules. So you will see there are various provisions in GST rules which are beyond the provisions of GST law, where the rules does not have any backing of the section, right? So if we talk about 36(4), this does not have any backing of GST Act. Then third, we have GST portal. So it is completely different. So these three things are running our GST system. So coming to the query, or sorry, coming to the issue which we're having. So if we missed reporting of a particular transaction, let's say April 19. So as per the law, you can report any or you can rectify any error or omission latest by the GST R1 of September 2020 in case of financial year 1920, right? So you can do it by September 20. If we take the similar example for April 18, so if even now till now I couldn't report my transaction in GSTAR 1 of April 18, can I do that? Now as per law it is not allowed because only till September 19 you can do it. But if you go to the GST portal, it will allow you. GST portal is still allowing. So that you can see the gaps are there in rules, laws and portals which we have to consider while advising our clients or while, you know, working, if we are working in an organization. So as per the law, law does not allow you. it may have implications later on if you are doing those amendments now for the financial year 18-19. Second, GSTR won the basic phenomenon, or we can say the basic framework. Why? Is that they want a invoice-wise reporting in those cases where the customer is also registered in GSTY, because that invoice will be reflecting in GSTR 2A, so that he can claim the credit and government can also come to know that the supplier is complying with the law and paying the taxes. So here also one aspect I just like to highlight, that filing of GSTR 1 and the government's dependency on GSTR 2A, that may be right, but reflecting of invoice in GSTR 2A does not ensure that your supplier has paid the taxes, right? So this government, although is having a dependency on GSTR 1, it may not ensure the complete compliances. So when we talk about GSTR 1 B2B, so you have to report invoice wise transaction. In case of B2C, if you have interstate transaction, means from one state to another state, and if your invoice value, your invoice value means including taxes, is more than 2.5 lakhs, then you have to report invoice wise, and otherwise you have to report state wise. And in case of intrastate, you have to report it consolidated wise, right? I hope I am you are audible to me, and you can see the screen as well. Then there are different aspects. Place of suppliers, you have to report under GSTR 1. Indication for GTA, the goods and travel agencies transporter, if they have adopted reverse charge mechanism, so they have to tick mark that we are not liable to pay tax, and our recipient will liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. We'll quickly look at GSTR 1 tables. I hope we are already aware, but just a quick review for refreshment. So we have supplies B2B under table 4, and table 5 is for interstate B2C more than 2.5 lakhs. Then we have table 6 for zero rated and deemed exports. This is a very important table, because now when we were talking about the importance of the compliances, so you can see here, you can witness here that the refund claims are being approved by the government only when you are correctly reporting your transactions under table 6 under zero rated. If your values are not matching with what your custom data says, your shipping bill says, then you may have a rejection of refund claim. Then in table 7, again we have B2C transactions. Table 8 has nil rated, exempted and non-GST supplies on consolidated basis. In table 9, we have amendments of table 4, 5 and 6, including credit notes and debit notes. You have to report here invoice wise. In table 10, you have to report amendments in table 7, which is for B2C. And for in table 11, you have to report separately. I think many of the taxpayers may not be following this, but wherever you are receiving any advance in case of services, you have to pay tax. Your liability triggers because that is the time of supply rules says. Even if you are raising an invoice maybe after 1 month, after 2 months, but first of all you have to pay taxes on advances. And then what happens, like if you are raising an invoice after 2 months, right, then you have to adjust the value of advances in this table itself, and that invoice you will report in table 4. So that's how it will go. And then we have to report HSN-wise summary for different parameters are there, and the details of documents issued, number of documents, the series of documents we have to report. And in all these scenarios, any supplies which if you are making through e-commerce portal has to be shown separately. So now I will come up to few practical issues which we are facing as a professionals or companies in GST urban. So the first thing I've already discussed. So I'll come up to second point, sale of motor vehicles. So, you know, there is a margin scheme wherein if you are selling any used or old motor vehicles, and if you have not claimed any ITC, on that motor vehicle. So what government says that you need not pay tax on the entire sale value. You pay tax only on the margin amount. What is the margin amount? Sale value minus WDV as per the Income Tax Act of this motor vehicle. So now in sometimes what happens, the taxable value comes out to zero, while that the margin amount is negative or maybe negative. So in case of negative margin value, you have to treat it as zero taxable value, means no tax implication. But when you will raise a tax invoice to your customer or maybe it is B2C transaction, so what will happen? You have to mention the taxable value is zero, but your invoice value will be showing the sale value, right? What is the actual sale value? Let's say rupees 100. So in this scenario, GSTR 1 portal, be it B2B or B2C, does not permit us to report any transaction with zero value. That's an issue. So in this case, either you have to report that transaction with rupees 1, or you cannot report it and you will have to simply report the series of documents which you have issued. Now, whether invoice once uploaded in GST 1 can be deleted? No, there is no provision. Either you have to amend it or you have to again make it zero. Or third, either you have to raise a credit note and nullify its effect. And sometimes, let's say you have amended one invoice. So again, the amendment of that amended invoice is not permitted. GST portal has its own limitation. It does not allow you, in especially in case of B2C. In 17-18, in various cases, this issue came up that earlier, because few vendors did not have the GST registration of the customers, so they reported those transactions under the B2C category. Uske baad, sir, vendors aate hain, sir, nahi, sir, mujhe credit nahi mil raha hai, so I just want you that you report this transaction under B2B. I am giving you the claim of the credit. So that what happened in that case, the we reclassified that transaction from B2C to B2B, or maybe the vice versa situation. So in this also we faced a lot of issues, because again, since we cannot amend the invoices, we have to first make those invoices value as zero. And here technically you cannot also raise a credit note, because the transaction has actually happened. Now all these scenarios have been taken care under the new returns. These are the problems which we are facing here. Right? Now in case of exports, if you are doing an export by courier, right? Currently, because of this COVID situation, various exports are happening, like in case of e-commerce companies, by courier. So in courier, you get a airway bill number, but you do not get a shipping bill number. But when you go to GSTR 1, although it is not mandatory, but you have a column only for shipping bill number. But when you have to file refund claim, then it is mandatory that you update the details with shipping bill number and date. But here you cannot update any airway bill number. Right? This is the issue. For hotels and restaurants, in most of those situations where the place of supply and GSTN of the recipient is different state by default, whenever you start uploading the data, based on the GSTN of the recipient, system automatically catches the place of supply, although it gives you permission that you can amend it, right? But we have to take care of it. I've seen some examples wherein few hotels, what they are doing, they are treating those transactions where in place of supply and GSTN. So what we mean by that, because we everyone know that in case of hotels and in restaurants, the place of supply is the location of the property. So suppose I am in Delhi, I have a hotel in Delhi. Now any customer who is registered customer in GST, he's in Gurgaon in different state, he comes to Delhi and stays in a hotel, and now here what happens, the place of supply is Delhi, but the GSTN of the recipient will be of Haryana. So both are in different states. So sometimes in few hotels, what they do, they report these transactions under the B2C category, which is wrong technically. If the portal is allowing you or permitting you, then you have to do correct reporting. Then we also face few issues in reporting for refund voucher in case of advances, where you have received an advance, You have paid the taxes, but you have not issued any invoice, and now that transaction has been cancelled. Or you have to revert back or refund back your advance, so you have to issue a refund voucher. So we face problem here also in refund voucher. And as per the government directions, what they always say that whenever you are making any adjustment in GSTR 3B or GSTR 1, please make sure that corresponding adjustments should be in the same month. It's like if you are reporting a certain transaction, let's say of April 2020 in May 2020 GSTR 1, so ideally you should also do that in GSTR 3B May 2020, obviously if you have not reported in GSTR 3B of April. So now coming to GSTR 3B, this is the main return where you pay the taxes, and also it has various flaws. We will discuss those. So if we talk about the structure now, earlier every taxpayer used to have the, you know, common due dates 20th, but then GST portal started showing a lot of tantrums and we're facing a lot of issues in filing GST returns. The government came up with a now staggered filing, wherein what they have done that for taxpayers having aggregate turnover, again emphasizing Pan India turnover up to 5 crores, so now they have given you option to file return by 22nd or 24th for the different states. So now if they have given you option, it means the due date of that return has been now 22nd or 24th of the next month. So even due date for tax payment also gets extended. So you can pay the tax by 22nd or 24th of month. And you can see here for 22nd is the, these are the states where they have to file for by 22nd, and other states starting from here they have to file. So they have split or they have a staggered filing system. And for having aggregate turnover more than 5 crores, due date will remain the same by 20th of the next month. Now what are the key points in GSTR 3B? In GSTR 3B, one of the biggest flaw which I can see, that the payment of tax has been linked with the due date of filing GSTR 3B. And not only it is linked, you cannot pay the taxes without filing GSTR 3B. Now this is fair departure from earlier regime. If you talk about central excise or service tax or maybe even in VAT. So whenever you want to pay tax, you can pay directly by creating a challan. And those references you can mention whenever you are filing those returns. And even returns are allowed to be filed with outstanding tax liabilities, like in service tax. Even you can file the returns, but now in GST, you are not allowed. First of all, you cannot file your GSTR 3B without setting off the tax liabilities. Now, many taxpayers misuse this provision. So there may be a genuine financial crunch that we can understand, but what they do, they keep filing nil returns, even though there may be a transactions or liability in that month. So this is wrong, because this tends to miss reporting of the transaction in that particular month, right? So we should not do that. We should wait, and only we should file return whenever we have the funds available. Although there may be a technical issue. Again, now I take one example. Suppose I have a total gross liability of 6 lakhs. I have an ITC of 3 lakhs. Now I need funds of 3 lakhs, but I don't have funds. Let's say I have funds only for 2 lakhs. Means now I can only pay 2 lakhs, but I don't have funds for 1 lakh. I am waiting for, you know, collection from my customer, and he may delay the collection maybe by 1 or 2 months. So because even the system is not allowing you for the partial payment of tax, so you have to make the full payment of tax. If you are not doing that, so now what will happen? Even if you have the funds for 2 lakhs, but once you file the return delayed, once you have the funds available for entire 3 lakhs, what will happen? You have to pay interest on the entire 3 lakhs at the rate of 18% per annum. So this is a huge financial implication, and I will suggest it's the biggest flaw of the GST system. They should interlink it. Second, you cannot file the current month return if returns of the previous period not filed. This is in case of 3B only. GSTR 1 is allowed because there is no tax implications, etc. So now this issue specifically was being faced by the companies under insolvency proceedings. So what was happening, what happened? So let's say a company went into insolvency proceeding. So IBC came into picture and insolvency resolution professional was appointed. So let's say the cutoff date is 31st of December 2019, the IRP was appointed. Now what happens whenever the IRP is appointed, the company gets an immunity from all the pending tax liabilities because that is added under the separate pool, we call it as a claim. So let's say company did not file return till June, file return only till June 2019. So they did not file return from July to December 2019. Now, since till December 19, even for outstanding liabilities, they have got the immunity. They need not pay the taxes because that will be classified under the claims. And once new IRP is appointed, now IRP is taking care of the entire company. So now he will start filing or complying with the taxes from January 20, but your GST portal will not allow. That forced the IRPs of various companies to drag GST department to NCLT. And NCLT has held that you have to allow the respondents, you have to allow the companies to file the returns, but since there was no facility, so now recently government has came up with a new special procedure. In that case, now they are saying you have to take a separate registration. So you can see because of this flaw that current month's return cannot be filed, they have to take another separate registration, again increase burden of the compliances. Third, there is no option to revise return. So in if you don't have any option to revise return, so now it gives a lot of cue to reconciliation exercises. So what will happen if you misreported your liability or you underreported your liability, you are claimed in excess. You cannot amend your return. You have to rectify or you have to make rectifications in the next month return. But again, you cannot do that latest by filing of September month of the next financial year. So this we have to take care. But again, this adds to the reconciliation exercise and manual exercise. We have to, you know, keep track of what were the transactions of that particular month, in how many months we have reported. So this is very typical. For GSTR-3B is now a return under section 39(1) that I have already discussed. This is one of the again very basic flaw. In a month where sales returns exceed sales, so what happens, let's say you have a sales of 100 and sales return of 150 in a particular month. So now you have a negative figure, negative values, you have to report sales return, but again GST portal will not allow you to do that because it does not allow you to report negative values in GST. Now this being taken care after 3 years under the new return regime. For any reduction in output tax liability in case of issuance of credit note, that also can be done within the specified timelines. In case of any addition in value of supply, what you have to do, we have to raise a debit note. Late filing fees are there, rupees 20 per day in case of nil return filing and 50 rupees per day in case of other than nil return filing. And even nil return filing is mandatory. Some of the taxpayers did not file returns if they did not have transactions. So we have to keep in mind nil return filing is mandatory and supplies by GTA. If any GTA is making any supplies, so there is no specific column in GSTR-3. And earlier even it was not allowing you to report under taxable column, but now they have allowed that you can report under taxable column and without any GST values. So let's look at few scenarios here, practical scenarios from the point of view of GSTR-3B. So let's say a sale transaction for April 2019 was there, but I missed reporting it. Now I did not even report it now, right? So as per the law, you can report it in the next month 3B, latest by September 2020, you can report it, and obviously you have to pay the interest also from April 19. But after that, legally, you are not allowed to do that, even if portal is allowing you to do that, because portal does not have those facility. But I will suggest you report it by either in GSTR 909C or you can also pay the tax directly under DRC 03. But please don't spoil your GSTR 3B. otherwise it will keep going on. Next, ITC on an invoice dated 15th of May 2019 and 15th of March 2019, not yet claimed, what will happen? So if we talk about on an invoice dated 15th of May 19, we can claim latest by September 2020 GSTR 3B, so we still have time. But when we are talking about 15th March 2019, now here even if I tweak this example that date of invoice is 15th March 2019, but in books of accounts I am recording in April 2019, means in the financial year 1920. So can I claim it? No, sir, because the timelines under 16.4 are from the date of invoice, not from what when you are reporting or recording in your books of account. So now you cannot claim it. Advance received on services and tax paid and invoice also issued. So means GST has been paid on advance. Already must have been adjusted because you already have issued the tax invoice. Now I just skipped here. So the scenario was that now the invoice got cancelled or the services got cancelled. So what will happen in that case? You have to issue a credit note and you can adjust the output liability under GSTR 3B. Then advance received on services and tax paid but no invoice issued, what will happen in that case? The refund voucher will be issued and refund of tax paid has to be claimed as per circular 137, the latest circular 13th April. Although if you go by the language, it says you can claim the refund. So can we say that it is not that I am not obliged to claim the refund, I can also adjust the liability, but again clarification is required. Now let's take an example, excess payment of tax by mistake, 1 lakh paid instead of 10,000. Now this is a genuine mistake. And there may be scenarios wherein you may not be able to adjust it even by September 2020, then what would happen? So in that case, you don't have any other option legally, you have to go for the refund claim for the excess payment of the tax. Now if one more scenario which we were discussing earlier, so in negative value, right, where my sales is 100, but credit note says 150. So in that particular month, I cannot report the transaction of credit note more than 100, means my I have to carry it forward next month, the differential amount of 50. So let's say my business got stopped or maybe there are no transactions for at least 4 or 5 months. And the timeline of September 2019 or 20, elapse, what will happen? So if we you know, go through the provision, what it says, the September 2019 or whatever 20 timeline is where when there any omission or is there any rectification. But this is a complete business scenario, this is a business situation that you are having a sales return and the GST portal is not allowing you to adjust. So this is not a omission or a rectification. So in my opinion, even if as per the law, the timelines are till September, then still you can claim it. You can adjust in GSTR 3B because we all know how difficult is it to, you know, claim refund. Government is making it more and more difficult by day by day. So that's all for GSTR 3B and GSTR 1. So, but these not are only compliances in GST as I mentioned earlier. They are various different compliances for different taxpayers. So let's quickly look at them. So under section 39.5, we have GSTR 5 for non-resident taxpayers. So there is a taxpayer called non-resident taxpayers. On similar line, we have casual taxpayers, wherein what happens in non-resident. You are normally, you are usually not having any business place in India. You are having a business place outside India, but you casually or you are at any event or any project in India, maybe for a limited period, for a temporary. So you are looking for a temporary registration. So you can apply under the non-resident taxpayers category, where you have to file GSTR 5 and it has to be filed till the time you are at that GST registration. And the due date is earlier of the 20th of the next month or the 7 days after the expiry of the registration. Then there is a special scheme for online information database access and retrieval service provider. So here I will simply give you a simple example of Netflix Prime Video, which is our only source of, you know, spending our time in during lockdown, right? So let's take an example. Netflix does not have any base in India because it's a US based company. So now, and since this this access to whom? Access to the videos, access to the different web cities. It is on digital platform, and that digital platform is having its server outside India, not in India. Now, what government has says, now if you are not registered in GST, means if you are an end consumer like me, I am an end consumer, for example, and I have subscribed for the Netflix. So now government says the Netflix has to, you know, take a registration in India and appoint a representative and file returns and pay the taxes on these transactions, because ultimately the services are being consumed in India. So for that matter, GSTR 5A has been notified, which you have to file on a monthly basis by 20th of the next month. Then we have GSTR 6, Input Service Distributor. This concept is not new, it was there in services also. So what happens in this case in Input Service Distributor? So let's take an example of a corporate office. I have a corporate office in Delhi. I am a manufacturer, so I am having registrations in, let's say, 15 states, having godowns, warehouses, factories, right? So I may be availing or receiving various common services in corporate office, which may be attributable to all my factories. So the best example could be, let's say, of audit fees, a company audit fee. So as a chartered accountant, I have raised an invoice to the corporate client at his corporate office. Now that audit happened for the entire company, so it means that service was attributable to entire company, including all the GST registration in different states. So the facility has been provided wherein you can take a registration under Input Service Distributor, or usme aap credit ko distribute kar sakte hain in different states to different registration based on the turnover criteria. For this, 13th of the day next month is the due date. And practically we faced a lot of issues while filing GSTR 6, because earlier it was linked with GSTR 1. Whenever the invoices will be reflected, we have to, you know, take action. Then again they made a changes, and recently if you go to the GST portal, again they are in in mid of doing some changes again. And I'll just like to update, if you have any data saved on GST portal in respect of IST till 14th April, so it will get deleted automatically because they are upgrading or doing some upgradation exercise. Then we have very important concept of tax deducted, which was introduced from 1st of October 2018. So what does it say? It is applicable mostly for the government departments and for few organizations or PSUs relating to the government. So as per this rule, any recipient, so let's say I am a company, I am a government department, I am taking any services of, let's say, of a construction contractor. He is constructing a building, right? So I have to deduct 2% as TDS on the turnover and pay to the government on his behalf. Once I pay it, then it will be reflecting under the TDS claim section of the GST portal at my contractor's end. And he can claim the credit. And once he claims the credit, then it will be reflecting in his cash ledger. So this is the compliance, the TDS deductor, and we have to take a separate registration for it. And then we have e-commerce operator. We all know that in case of e-commerce operator, a separate registration as a tax collector. If any sellers are doing any business transactions on the e-commerce platform, right? An e-commerce operator is collecting money on behalf of sellers from the buyers. On those collections, they have to collect TCS at the rate of 1%. So whatever rates I am, this is total rate, means CGST 0.5%, SGST 0.5%. Again in TDS, 2% means CGST 1%, SGST 1%, in case of IGST 2%. So 1% I have to collect tax on behalf of all those sellers and I have to pay to the government, and it will be reflected under the cash ledger of my different suppliers. But again, separate registration I have to take on, and here I have to take registrations in every state where my sellers are operating, right? So if I have a head office and entire platform I am running only from Bangalore, let's say Amazon, but he's having e-commerce sellers across India, so they have to take registration in every state to follow this compliances as e-commerce operator tax collector. Then we have GSTR 11 is there for UN bodies and specialized agencies where refund claim is allowed to these agencies on the purchases. For this GSTR 11 has been notified and they have to file by 20th of the next month. Then GST 9 we already discussed, which also will be discussing separately. So I'll be skipping here. Then we have GST 9A by composition taxpayer on an annually basis by 31st of December. So these are the due dates as per the provisions of the law. In case of annual return, we all know that the due dates have been extended for 18, 19 till 30th June 2020. Again, in case of 9C also, the due date has been extended. Then GSTR 10 final return, although maybe not many people are aware about this return, but this is a crucial return. Why? Because it has a late fee implication. So whenever if you are surrendering your registration and your registration got cancelled, you have to mandatorily file, even if there is no transactions or there is no stock, you have to mandatorily file final return GSTR 10 within 3 months of the cancellation. And if people who have forgot to file this, now system is giving a mandatory late fee of 5,000 maximum. So these all are returns, and some are statements also, like GSTR 8 is not a return, but it's a statement. So apart from them, I have also added here DRC 03. So this is neither a return nor a statement, but it has picked up a lot of popularity from last 2 years. Because it is a scheme where if you have missed any reporting under GSTR 3B, you could not pay tax for let's say for 17, 18, even now for 18, 19. So you have a facility, you can pay the tax by filing this intimation. We call it DRC 03. So this is a voluntary payment intimation notified under 73.5. And it also allows you to utilize ITC as well. You can also utilize the ITC. I hope you can see the screen. So we will also take up questions after end of the session, right? So these all are the returns and statements. Now moving forward to composition taxpayer. So a couple of compliances here also in composition taxpayer. So composition taxpayer is a scheme where government says up to a certain limit of 1.5 crores and you are only having a intra-state supplies. So in that case, what you can do, you can opt for a composition scheme wherein you will have to do only one thing. You have to list down your turnover for a quarter and pay tax at the certain percentage. You cannot collect the tax, you cannot claim the credit, you need not file any GSTR 3 or GSTR 1. So now suppose if I was under a normal tax pay regime in 1920, now I want to shift to the composition scheme. So in that case, I have to file intimation before the end of the financial year. By 31st of March 2020, I have to file the financial year, right? But that date has been extended to 30th of June 2020. So whenever I am switching from normal to composition scheme, so definitely there may be, if I am a trader or a manufacturer, I may have a stock in my, godown or something as on the date of starting of the financial year from when I will be shifting to the composition scheme. So in that case, whatever ITC, if I have claimed any on strong line as on the date on the 1st April. I have to reverse that ITC. For that, I have to file ITC 03 within 60 days of the starting of the financial year, means 30th May 2020. But revised due date is 31st of July 2020. In case of composition taxpayer, from last financial year, what they have done that you have to file not GST R4, but you have to file CMP 08 on a quarterly basis. And you will also pay the taxes on a quarterly basis. But for January to March, that due date has been extended to 7th of July 2020. And annually basis, on an annual basis, you have to file one GST R4 for financial year 2019-20. The existing due date was 30th April, which you can file by 15th of July. So this is when I am opting for a composition scheme. There may be a different scenario if I am opting for a normal scheme, or my turnover crossed that threshold of 1.5 crores, or I have done any interstate supply. So by compulsorily, I have to go into the normal scheme. So whenever I go into the normal scheme, again, I have to give the intimation under CMP 04. That has to be done before withdrawal, right? And whenever I'm going into a normal schemes, again, the question comes that what about the stock which is lying, right? I hope you can see the slide of composition taxpayer, right? I hope you can see the slides now. Okay. So moving forward. So what I was telling, in case when I am going into the normal scheme, so I must have a stock as on date on 1st of April 2000, or maybe whatever the date when I am shifting to the normal scheme. And in case of shift to normal scheme, there is no date that you have to shift on 1st of April itself. You can shift even during the mid of the financial year. So if I have any stock in my godown or premises, so I can claim the ITC on those stock. Why? Because ultimately, whenever I'll be selling those goods, I have to pay GST and collect. So that's why government provides a facility. You can file ITC 01 and you can claim the credit on those stocks. And even credit is also allowed on the capital goods, which is reduced by the 5 percentage points for every quarter as per the calculation, but you can do it. So moving to what are other returns in GST, mostly pertaining to ITC. So ITC 01 we have just discussed. So there can be even different situations in this, where ITC 01 is used to claim any credit available on stock. I'll give you an example. So as a practicing chartered accountant, let's say I've just started my new practice. So my turnover is less than 20 lakhs. After 2 years, my turnover crossed the threshold of 20 lakhs. So now I have to register, right, for GST. But again, because this is for a stock, so we can take an example of a trader. So let's say if I have my threshold crossed 40 lakhs, right? Now I will apply for the registration within 30 days. Now there will be interim period and there will be stock as on the date of registration, effective date of the registration. Now, since I have to apply GST, pay GST from the date of registration, so whatever stock is lying in my premises, government allows you to claim the credit. So you can use this ITC 01 for filing that. Next, there can be scenarios where I was a proprietor firm. Let's say I was a proprietor firm, practicing firm. Now I have converted or got merged into a big partnership firm. So what will happen to the credit which is lying under the credit ledger as on the date of change in the constitution of firm? So you can transfer the credit from your merged firm, from your proprietor firm, wherein any credit is lying, to the your new merged entity by filing ITC 02. And this can also be done in case of change in constitution, like for merger, for Amal Commission, for any other transfer of business, you can use this ITC02. Then recently a new rule came up where in earlier, if you are aware that there was a concept of business vertical that you can take the separate registration in a same state if you are following a criteria of the business vertical, which now has been removed. So now if someone earlier was having a consolidated registration when GST started, now they want to split their registration into two parts, means they want to take two registrations in the same state. So definitely there may be ITC which may pertain to both the businesses. So by filing ITC02A, what you can do, you can transfer the credit pertaining to that business into your new GST registration, right? Then we have ITC04 is used to report the transactions of job work. So whenever you are sending any goods to job work and you are receiving goods from your job worker, you have to file this ITC04. So this ITC04 was, you know, relaxed till 31st March 2019, means you need not file it, but then you have to file it on a quarterly basis. You have to file this ITC04 by 25th of the next month. Okay, so now we come to tax payment under GST. So we have talked about the returns and everything. So again, when we file returns, we also have to pay the tax. So there were different, there were various changes during 3 years in the, I will say, in the credit utilization. So since we have three kind of taxes, CGST, SGST and IGST, we should be aware how these credits, input tax credit of these three taxes, we can utilize while setting up our tax liabilities, because everyone wants to first utilize their ITC, for which the relevant provisions are 49A, 49B, and we have a newly inserted 88A, which was inserted from February 2019. And again, the beauty that the provision was inserted in February 2019, but on the portal, on GST portal, it actually came into effect only from July 2009, right? Okay, so first of all, what the rule says, input tax credit on account of integrated tax. So first of all, you have to utilize your entire credit of IGST first. So first, you will use it against your IGST liability. And if any balance remains, you can use in any order. Means either you can use for CGST or for SGST. So suppose you have a IGST credit of 1000 and 500 you have a IGST liability. So now you have a 500 remaining IGST credit after setting off your IGST liability. Now that entire 500 you have to first use to set off CGST and SGST. Only then you can claim or utilize the credit of CGST and SGST. So first order, use entire IGST credit first. Second, for CGST, you have to first use it for CGST liability. And then if any balance, you can use it for IGST. And in any case, CGST and SGST both cannot be offset with each other, right? And similarly for SGST, you will first use it for SGST liability, and then any balance you can use it for IGST liability. So if we take an example here, so let's say I have an integrated tax liability, it is noted of 1000, and here you can see the table, right? So we quickly look at it directly at the example. So now the integrated tax credit of 1000, what I will do, I will first use it against my, I have a 1300 ITC, so I'll use against my output liability of 1000 first. Then balance, I have a 300. So 300, I have an option, either I can use entirely for CGST, entirely for SGST, or in part. I can also use here 150, 150. So this is the example. Then what will happen for CGST? Now, what is the balance of credit I have for CGST? I have 200. So first 200, I will first use it, 100 for utilizing my CGST liability, and 200 I have already offset. So my liability, now my balance credit is of CGST, and similarly I will do for SGST. So now we will look at GST 9 and 9C. This is very important and crucial aspect of and even for the practitioners and for even for those taxpayers who have got their GST registration only in 2018-19 or who are crossing the turnover limit and now under the banner of audit, right? So section 35 subsection 5 mandates the audit of the accounts, right? Wherein every registered person whose turnover during a financial year exceeds the prescribed limit has to get his accounts audited by CA or a cost accountant, and he has to submit a copy of the audited annual accounts and reconciliation statement, which we call it GSTR 9C. So along with GSTR 9, you have to furnish GSTR 9C if you are also under the audit limit. And then we have section 44 subsection 2, which talks about the annual return. Then we have rule 80 sub rule 3, which says that every registered person other than the departments of central government or state government wherein this GST audit does not apply, whose aggregate turnover during a financial year exceeds 2 crore rupees, shall get his accounts audited as specified under subsection 5 of 35 and shall furnish copy of audited annual accounts in form 9C. So what you have to do, you have to file 9, you have to furnish your audited accounts, and you have to furnish your 9C. And here, now this rule has been changed for 18-19. The time limit we will just see. So for GSTR 9, for 18-19 we are talking about, because 17-18 has already been passed. So GSTR 9, it is optional for taxpayers having aggregate turnover up to 2 crores. And for others, you have to file by 30th of June 2020. 9C, it is optional for taxpayers having aggregate turnover up to 5 crores, and for others it is to be filed by 30th of June. So this limit earlier was 2 crores, the audit limit. Now it has been changed to 5 crores for 18-19, not for 17-18. And only for 18-19, not for every other financial year. So when we talk about GSTR 9 and 9C, the first question comes up, sir, कि इसका बेसिस क्या होना चाहिए, कि हम इसको कैसे बनाए, हम इसको GSTR 1 से बनाए, GSTR 3B से बनाए, या बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट से बनाए। सर, देयर कैन नॉट बी एनी ब्लैंकेट आंसर, यू हैव टू कंसीडर ऑल दीज, बिकॉज़ ऑल दीज GSTR 1 3B एंड बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स आर रिलेवेंट। अगर आप उनके इंस्ट्रक्शंस पढ़ते हैं, इंस्ट्रक्शंस में कहीं पर लिखा हुआ है दैट यू कैन यू नो यूज द टेबल्स ऑफ GSTR 1, कहीं पर लिखा है आप GSTR 3B यूज कर सकते हैं। So in my opinion, what should be the timelines, or rather what should be the key step? So you should prepare it by taking books of accounts as a base, considering that it contains the correct record of sales and purchase, including ITC and RC. Because what happens, books of accounts is the reliable base which even we as an auditor can rely. You cannot rely on the data of 3B or 1 because you have not audited GSTR 3B or GSTR 1. What you are audited is books of accounts. And even for income tax and other companies at purposes, books of accounts would be my final data. There may be some errors or mistakes while filing GSTR 1 or 3B. But again, I have to make a parallel reconciliation between GSTR 1, 3B and books of accounts. Why I have to do that? Now, what I will do for preparing GSTR 9. So first, I have to take books of accounts as a base. Then I have to split data into two parts. Why? Because what would happen, books of accounts is one basket. Now, out of, let's say I have a business, I have a GST liability of 1000. Let's say out of 1000, 800 I have reported in the GSTR 3B for 18-19 itself. And 200 I have paid my tax liability under GSTR 3B, which I have filed after 1819, means in 1920, because law permits you that you can file or adjust or rectify your transactions till September of the next financial year. So I have to split my transactions into two parts for the purposes of reporting. So the first part will go into table 4, and second part will go into table 10 and 11 separately. Now, why GSTR 1 is not relevant here? Because GSTR 1 is not giving you a clear picture of what actually the tax payment you have made. And when you go into the table 9 of GSTR 9, it auto-populates figures from GSTR 3B, the payment details which you cannot modify, right? So that's why 3B should be the reliable after books of accounts to prepare or your GSTR 9. In my personal opinion, there can be different opinions. So now there's one more confusion which comes in table 5 of GSTR 9C. If you will look at of table 5 for GSTR 9C, so 9C kya hai? 9C is simply nothing but a reconciliation of your books of accounts in one end and your GSTR 9 at your other end. So reconciliation of outward and as well as your inward supplies, right? Now when you go into table 5, there are a couple of different parameters. It says that you have to first report the turnover as per your books of accounts, but there is no definition of turnover. What should be turnover as per books of accounts? Whether it should only be my core revenue item, or it should also include operating revenue? And what about other income? There are a couple of these transactions which are there, or even there for that matter, in other income, we may also report discounts on purchases, right? Or any other claims. Although these are out of the purview of GST, like duty drawback, state incentives, those are out of purview of GST, but these are appearing in my revenue, or you can say in my revenue in the financial statement. So what I should do while reporting under table 5? In my opinion, revenue from operations and operating revenue should be my base. I should not report other income. And again, this is the general scenario. We have to see on a case-to-case basis what exactly is going into other income. If you are reporting even your non-core revenue under other income, so again, a blanket formula cannot be applied. So crux is, if something which is not coming under the four corners of supply of GST, like duty drawback or a state incentive, income tax refund, or you can say the transactions which are outside the purview of GST, so you need not report under your turnover, and you can simply do the adjustments under 5-4 if required. Again, there may be different views here. So looking to different scenarios and the reporting structure. So first, sales and credit notes reported in GSTR 3B in 1819, but reported in GSTR 1 in 1990. It is what I should do in GSTR 9. Now again, since you have already paid the tax in GSTR 3B, so in my suggestion, you should report this transaction in table 4, even though there is a separate column of table 10, 11, 12, and 13 for transactions which you are reporting in the next financial year. But since you have already paid the taxes, and if you look at table 9, it is auto-populating the data from table from GSTR 3B, so that should be the suggestion. Next, sales credit note reported in GSTR 1819, but reported in 3B in 1920. So now, since you have not paid the taxes in 3B in 1819, so you should report it separately under table 10 to 13. Then we have sales and credit notes reported only in GSTR 1, but not reported till now in GSTR 3B. इसका क्या मतलब है? इसका मतलब है कि आज तक मैंने अभी तक tax liability उस पे पे ही नहीं करी, तो उसको तो मेरे को टैक्स पे करना पड़ेगा, और ठीक टैक्स पे करने के लिए मेरे को टेबल 4 में दिखाना पड़ेगा, विच इज ऑल्सो इन लाइन विद वॉट प्रेस रिलीज ऑफ डेटेड 3rd of July 2019 सेज. देन सेल्स रिपोर्टेड ओनली इन जीएसटीआर 3B बट नॉट रिपोर्टेड टिल नाउ इन जीएसटीआर 1, सो नाउ नो अमेंडमेंट कैन बी डन इन जीएसटीआर 1, बट सिंस टैक्स ऑलरेडी पेड, सो दिस ओनली अ मैकेनिज्म, इट्स एन एरर और क्लेरिकल मिस्टेक. There is no tax evasion, because since you have already paid the taxes, you can report under table 4. These are on the sales side. Now we look at the input tax credit side. ITC availed in books in 1819, but reported in 3B 1920. So again, you have to report it separately under table 13. ITC availed in books in 1819, but reversed in 3B 1920. Please disclose separately in table 12. ITC wrongly availed in books in 1819. And not reversed till now. So again, since you have not reversed, So again, if you go to the press release and even the schema of the GSTN, there is no column where you can reverse ITC now. Whatever you have already reversed in 3B, that you can just report. But if you need to reverse it now, you cannot report in GSTN 9. You should do it in GSTN 9C. And if you do not have any 9C parameter, so you are not supposed to file 9C, in that case, you can simply file these DRC 03 and pay the taxes. And you can also write an intimation to your department. Next. So now this is again important. A lot of confusions happen here. So, you know, GST auditor, whether a GST auditor can be separate or can be different from company auditor, means your stat auditor, your income tax auditor, or not. So if when you file GST 9C, there is one table 4 which says, are you liable to audit under any act? Please specify. And when you go to the Excel utility, and whenever you click on yes or no, the form, whether you are filing part 1 or part 2, changes. So here we are talking only about the certification part B. In what scenarios and when you have to file part 1 and when you have to file part 2, because this is really important, because as a practicing, we are assigning our signature, so we have to be very cautious here. So now part 1 is when a statutory auditor is the GST auditor, means your books of accounts have been audited by a GST auditor, then you have to fill up the part 1. And if you have a tax auditor, you are a proprietorship firm or a partnership firm, and you are under the income tax audit limit. So tax auditor is GST auditor, so again you will file part 1. Because you will say, it also happens in, we are all aware about the tax audit. So tax audit, what happens, 3CD and 3CB. So this is the same here. So if you are already audited under any other law, then in that case, what would happen? And the same auditor is again auditing your GST, then part 1 will go. So if no audit undertaken under any other law, then audit of books of accounts to be done by GST auditor now. I'll give you a very good example here. You must have heard about commission agents, Adati agents, right, in agricultures and different industries. What practically happens? So let's take an example. I have made a sale of 10 lakhs, right? Let's say I have made a sale of 10 lakhs, correct? Now, I purchased for 10 lakhs. Now I will sell it out in the market. Let's say after hitting my margin of 2%, I'll be selling for 10 lakhs plus 2% margin, right? So from GST point of view, I have to report the 10 lakhs 20,000 as my turnover outward supplies. But when we go to the income tax, as per the income tax, I think there is some circular which says that in case of income tax, normally and even practically what happens, only the commission income of 2% is recognized as a revenue in books of accounts. So what will happen in that case, you will not be coming under the audit parameter of income tax, but for GST, you have to get your books of accounts audited. But in this scenario, you have not audited under any other law. So it means your GST auditor, if you have any GST auditor, that GST auditor has to first audit your books of accounts, and then he will furnish part 1. And in all other cases, part 2, when GST auditor and any other auditor, tax auditor, state auditor is different, then you will file part 2. So now we'll be looking at what are the key aspects of GST audit or annual return, or what are the key considerations which we should keep in mind while in audit, and it also contains our experience from 17-18. Reversal of ITC on non-payment to vendors for more than 180 days. This is very crucial, and most of the clients, you will say, if you will look at the creditors aging, you will definitely find some gaps there, that tax payment including B the payment against the invoice has not been done under within 180 days from the date of invoice. So in that case, there is a reversal requirement along with the interest implications as per the rule, and the interest has to be charged from the first day of the date of availment. We should look at this aspect carefully. ITC reversal, many clients, or you will say many taxpayers, have not done ITC reversal on exempted supplies. So when you have a poor revenue of exempt suppliers, so that time you can take care. But let's say you have a exempt supply of MEISA, so you are an exporter. So an exporter, what you do, you get some export incentives in the form of MEIS scripts, and that is saleable in the market. And on that sale, there is no GST liability. Earlier it was at 12%, then it came down to 5%, but as of now it is exempted under GST. So since it is exempted under GST, then you have to reverse your common ITC here. And most of the taxpayers might have not done this. Again, if we talk about interest income, on interest income, we need not do the ITC reversal, but there is another one, transaction in securities. So if any corporate companies, if they are, you know, surplus funds are there, so they have invested in mutual funds or into the share market. So even transaction in securities has been treated as under the value of exempt supplier. And as per the rule, 1% of the sale value of the security has been treated as value of the exempt supplier. So while doing reversal under ITC, you have to consider the transaction in securities also. Proper identification is also required of common ITC, because it is important what all are common from my business point of view. And then there is a separate reversal for capital goods under rule 43, and separate reversal under for rule 42 for inputs and input services. In one of the clients, we came to know that they were doing receiving invoices, but they were not actually receiving goods or services. So this is really important, the fake ITC. Please make sure that whatever ITC has been claimed, it has been claimed on a genuine transaction, and they have all the documents in place, transportation documents in place, GRN, stock register, and also the physical verification, where you can establish that ITC has been claimed on the genuine transaction. Whether any ITC has been claimed on expenses which are ineligible under section 17.5, most of the time, sometimes happens, client says, sir, koi baat nahi, agar le bhi hai to koi baat nahi, us time assessment ke time dekha jayega, audit ke time. Audit not of a GST auditor, but jab kabhi department agar audit karega, aap usko abhi jaane. But sir, as a GST auditor, we have a responsibility to report this transaction. Agar wahan pe agar koi galat credit claim kari gayi hai under 17.5 mein, jo block credit se bahut hai. Sometimes we miss transactions of sale of capital goods, fixed assets, even scrap sales hota hai, kabhi aapne cash receipt kar liya aur books mein usko other income mein dikha diya par us pe tax jama nahi karaya. So that we should see. Cross charging from head office to branches, if undertaken or not, or any other inter branch transactions. So most of the time, in case of service provision, we do not come to know. So this is a very hot topic, hot issue about cross charging. And as per the law, it is very legal and we have to do. As of now, we don't have any other option, or we don't have any other clarification from the department, and we also have the negative rulings on this. Cross charging has to be done. Transition credit of secondary and higher education sets, EC, KKC claim, so that will not be allowed. So please make sure that your client is reversing it. Then interest on delayed payment of GST or delayed filing of GSTR 3B resulting into GST. So sometimes what happens, let's say GSTR 3B, I wish to file on 20th, but maybe because of shortage of funds, I filed on 24th, only mere delay of 3 to 4 days. So I completely ignore that I have to pay tax and also interest on that delayed payment. So during audit, please make sure for every month, please make an exercise that if GSTR 3B has been filed delayed, right? So definitely there would be interest implication if there was any tax liability on net amount. So now it has been clarified, only on the net amount there will be interest implications. Please scrutinize the entire credit side of P&L, and even this is also done by the revenue officers. and we should also structure the transaction, means legally we should structure appropriately as per the books of accounts to avoid any unnecessary questions like discounts, other income, recovery of costs credited under exemption set. What happens in case of salaries? You can find some credit entries where there is a notice pay recovery, but on the face of the P&L you are not able to file it because it has been adjusted from the expenses. Please take care of these kind of scenarios. Canteen recovery, whether any non-compliant pre-GST credit notes issued. So if we talk about transitional issue, pre-GST credit notes were allowed, means credit note issued in GST in respect of transactions before GST was allowed only in case of rate revision, otherwise not. In case of any other sales item, mandatorily your recipient has to issue a tax invoice and you have to book it as a purchase. In one of our clients, we have faced this issue that there we issued a lot of pre-GST credit notes, so we should keep it in mind. Proper backup of amounts being disclosed in table 5-4. So now 5-4 is optional, means in the sense the table 5, from 5B to 5N, what they have done that you need not bifurcate all the adjustment, you simply mention in 5-4. But I am always suggesting, please keep maintain the breakup and even disclose. If for any purposes you are not able to disclose, but at least keep a proper backup of the amounts which you are disclosing under 5-4. Because as a GST auditor, we have a responsibility. So this 5-4, I am talking about GSTR 9C. Exports without payment of GST without filing letter of undertaking. So since there is no actual checks and balances whenever you do export, right? So you do it. So if anyone has done any export, this issue normally come up in case of services, right? So if you have got any remittances from outside India and you have raised an invoice without GST, but when you check, your client did not file a letter of undertaking, which is mandatory, only then you can do the exports. So otherwise there may be GST implications and it may not be treated as a zero rated supplies. Next, whether GST charged on incidental expenses like freight, insurance, declared and tax invoice, service charge. Sometimes what happened, the ledger of the freight is different, ledger of the sales are different, and freight ledger is a running account where some companies, what they do, say they credit the recoveries from the customer, and on the same side they also debit the expenses which they are incurring on the freight charges. So on the face you cannot see the larger picture. So please deep dive into the books of accounts of the client, right, and to have make sure that it is completely GST compliant. Then if TRAN 1 or 2, if was filed after 31st of March 2018, then it has to be reported in GST 9 of 2018-19. Why? Because under credit ledger, it was appearing after 17-18. And make sure you have not reported that kind of transaction in the GST 9 of 17-18. So now coming to recent relaxation in compliances under GST. So we have seen after this COVID-19 situation, there have been decent couple of relaxations which have been provided by the government, and various notifications have been issued on 3rd of April 2020. So the major relief was provided under Rule 36, Subrule 4. So just for the benefit of all, what exactly is this rule? So from 9th of October 2019, now what government says that will not be able to give you the entire credit which you are claiming as per your books of accounts. So humne kya kiya ki aap ye karo ki aap monthly basis pe apna GSTR 2A reconcile karo. Ab us GSTR 2A mein se aap filter karo your eligible ITC. Ab wo aap claim kar lo. सपोज आपकी बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट के हिसाब से आई टी सी बनती थी ₹100. नाउ आपके जीएसटीआर 2A में इट इज अपीयरिंग ओनली ₹60. तो व्हाट गवर्नमेंट सेज कि हम आपको एक तो ₹60 के आई टी सी अलाउ कर देंगे इन दैट मंथ, और आप 10% ऑफ ₹60, मीन्स 10% ऑफ द एलिजिबल आई टी सी विच इज अपीयरिंग इन 2A, in respect of rupees 40, which is not appearing. तो अगेंस्ट रुपीज 100 आप 60 प्लस 6 टोटल 66 के आईटीसी आप उस महीने में क्लेम कर, और व्हेनेवर योर सप्लायर यू नो योर सप्लायर गिव्स यू अपलोड्स द इनवॉइसेस इन जीएसटीआर 1 एंड इट स्टार्टेड रिफ्लेक्टिंग इन योर जीएसटीआर 2 देन यू कैन क्लेम दैट आईटीसी, और ये मंथली कैलकुलेशन आपको करनी है. सो मेजर रिलीफ यहां पे ये दिया गया, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल there is only be a deferment of this rule, there is not be relaxation ki rule ko hata diya gaya, sir usko defer kiya gaya hai ki aapko ye jo rule hai iska jo application hai jo 10% wala jo rule hai ye aapko february 2020 se lekar august 2020 ke beech mein nahi follow karna hai, iska matlab us beech mein aap itc as per your books of accounts claim kar sakte hain, and september 2020 mein jaake on a cumulative basis फरवरी से लेकर अगस्त के क्यूमुलेटिव बेसिस पे आप उसकी कैलकुलेशन करें जो 10% वाला रूल है कि कितना आपने आईटीसी आपकी बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट से जो आपने क्लेम किया कितना आईटीसी आपकी ड्यू में अपीयर हो रहा है, कितना आईटीसी ड्यू में अपीयर नहीं हो रहा है, देन आप उसका रूल लगाएं 10% वाला, और जो भी एडजस्टमेंट होगा या तो एक्सेस होगा या शॉर्टफॉल होगा उसका एडजस्टमेंट आप फाइनली सेप्टेम्बर 2020 में जाकर करते हैं. सो दिस इज दी बिगेस्ट first relaxation. What are the relief relating to GSTR CV? Before coming to that, so e-way bill mein bhi ek relaxation diya gaya hai ki jahan pe kya hua tha ki lockdown announce hua us time bahut sare aise trucks honge goods and transit honge jo raste mein rahe aur wo wahi ke wahi atak gaye. Ab jab wo lockdown ke baad chalenge apni particular jo bhi destination hai apni current location se aur destination ki taraf jayenge तो उनके पास जो ईवे बिल होगा वो एक्सपायर हो चुका होगा, क्योंकि ईवे बिल की एक पर्टिकुलर टाइमलाइंस होती है, वैलिडिटी होती है. तो सरकार ने ये कहा जिन ईवे बिल्स की एक्सपायरी 20 मार्च से लेकर 15 अप्रैल के बीच में है, एनी ईवे बिल व्हिच इज एक्सपायरिंग बिटवीन दीज टू डेट्स, उनकी जो ड्यू डेट है उसकी जो वैलिडिटी है हम उसको बढ़ा देंगे 30 अप्रैल 2020 तक. But now since second lockdown has been announced, so definitely we should expect few more relaxations or deferment or extension in the validity of that e-visa. So coming to GSTR 3B, sir, पहले GSTR 3B की बात करें तो सबसे पहले एक जो confusion आ रहा था in different towns कि सर क्या GSTR 3B की due date extend हुई है या सिर्फ conditional relief मिला गया है इंटरेस्ट और लेट फी का. तो सर मैं बता दूं आपको सिर्फ मई 2020 का जीएसटीआर 3B की डेट एक्सटेंड हुई है, उसके अलावा जो आपको रिलैक्सेशन दिया है फरवरी 2020 मार्च 2020 एंड अप्रैल 2020 उसमें देयर इज नो एक्सटेंशन इन ड्यू डेट. तो इसका क्या मतलब है, अगर सर ड्यू डेट का एक्सटेंशन नहीं हुआ इसका मतलब कि आपको इंटरेस्ट और जो लेट फी का वेवर है वो अलग से कंडीशनली सेटिस्फाई करना पड़ेगा, और जहां पे ड्यू डेट एक्सटेंड हो जाती है देन देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन ऑफ इंटरेस्ट और लेट फी, क्योंकि जब ड्यू डेट ही एक्सटेंड होगी तो आप उस डेट तक टैक्स पेमेंट कर सकते हैं. तो अभी जो बेनिफिट दिए गए हैं सरकार ने उसको तीन पार्ट्स में डिवाइड किया है. फॉर टैक्स पेयर्स हैविंग टर्नओवर एग्रीगेट टर्नओवर अगेन पैन इंडिया बेसिस मोर देन 5 करोड़, देन मोर देन 1.5 बट अप टू 5 करोड़ एंड अप टू 1.5. तो मोर देन 5 करोड़ में उन्होंने बोला है कि आप विद इन 15 डेज from the existing due date, suppose March 2020 का 3B मेरे को फाइल करना है 20 अप्रैल को, तो 20 अप्रैल के बाद 15 दिन आप और जोड़ लीजिए, तब तक अगर आप अपना 3B फाइल कर देते हैं including tax payment, यहाँ पे I'm emphasizing कि उस महीने का जो भी transaction है आपको उसी 3B में दिखाना है और उसका tax payment करना है, अगर आप उसको अगले 3B में ले जाएंगे तो ये benefit नहीं मिलेगा. तो tax payment अगर आप और return फाइल कर देते हैं within 15 days तो आप सब कोई भी interest charge नहीं करेंगे, इसका मतलब 15 डेज का बेनिफिट है. उसके बाद फाइल करेंगे तो चलो सर हमने आपको 50% और रिलीफ दे दिया, आप 9% की रेट से पर है ना इंटरेस्ट पे करते हैं टिल सर्टेन डेट्स जो हम आगे डिस्कस करेंगे, और वेवर फ्रॉम लेट फी से अगेन टिल सर्टेन डेट्स, और उसके बाद अप टू 1.5 करोड़ में भी दो पार्ट्स में, बिकॉज यहाँ पे डेट्स डिफरेंट है इसलिए मैंने उसको अलग से यहाँ पे क्लासीफाई किया है, और वहां पे पैरामीटर सेम है आइदर नल इंटरेस्ट या फिर 18% इंटरेस्ट. सर एक चीज इसमें और बता दूं कि ये बेनिफिट तभी मिलेगा आप अगर आप उस पर्टिकुलर टाइमलाइंस तक इसको फुलफिल कर लेते हैं। अगर आपने फुलफिल नहीं किया तो आपको डे वन से इंटरेस्ट और लेट फी देना पड़ेगा और इंटरेस्ट लगेगा 18%। और सेकंड चीज यहाँ पे समझने वाली है कि क्योंकि यहाँ पे दो फाइनेंशियल ईयर्स आ गए हैं, फेब्रुवरी मार्च इज फॉर 1920, अप्रैल मई इज फॉर 2020, तो आपको जो एग्रीगेट टर्नओवर देखना है वो देखना होता है प्रीवियस फाइनेंशियल ईयर का। फेब्रुवरी और मार्च के लिए आप देखेंगे 18-19 का और अप्रैल मई के लिए आप देखेंगे कौन सा टर्नओवर 1920 का, और दिस इज ऑल्सो इम्पोर्टेंट। तो ये टेबुलेशन से आप यहाँ पे देख सकते हैं फॉर मोर देन 5 करोड़, तो मई 2020 का आप देख सकते हैं कि यहाँ पे हाईलाइटेड है, उसमें जो ड्यू डेट कर दी गई वो कर दी गई 27 जून तक, और तब तक तो कोई लेट फी नहीं लगेगी, उसके बाद 18% का इंटरेस्ट है। देन फेब्रुवरी मार्च एंड अप्रैल के केस में निल इफ फाइल्ड विद इन 15 डेज, वो डिफरेंट डेट्स है। उसके बाद 9% पर एनम से इंटरेस्ट आपको लगेगा कब, अगर आप 24 जून 2020 तक, फेब्रुवरी मार्च अप्रैल तीनों रिटर्न्स अगर आप 24 जून 2020 तक फाइल कर देंगे इंक्लूडिंग टैक्स पेमेंट, तो 9% का इंटरेस्ट है और तब तक आपको लेट फी का भी वेवर। उसके बाद फाइल करेंगे तो आपको पूरे डे वन से 18% देना पड़ेगा और लेट फी भी देनी पड़ेगी। ये बात होगी GSTR 3B की। GSTR 1 की बात करें तो फेब्रवरी 2020 क्योंकि मंथली रिटर्न है, कोई भी चेंज नहीं है, उसका ड्यू डेट एक्सटेंड हो गया है। मार्च अप्रैल और मई अगेन ड्यू डेट में कोई चेंज नहीं, पर लेट फीस का वेवर है कि 30 जून तक भी अगर आप फाइल करेंगे तो हम कोई भी लेट फी चार्ज नहीं करेंगे। यहाँ पे बता दूं कि प्रैक्टिकली हो सकता है कि लेट फी नहीं लगती जब हम GSTR 1 फाइल करते हैं, पर लीगली एज पर लॉ लेट फीस का प्रावधान है। देन टर्नओवर मोर देन 1.5 करोड़ बट अप टू 5 करोड़, उस केस में क्या है GSTR 3B, ऐसा कि हम सब जानते हैं अप टू 5 करोड़ में क्या है, अप टू 5 करोड़ में डिफरेंट स्टेट्स के लिए डिफरेंट ड्यू डेट्स है, किसी के लिए 22 तारीख है, किसी के लिए 23 तारीख है। तो उसमें क्या कहा गया, फॉर फेब्रवरी एंड मार्च अगर आप निल इंटरेस्ट है, अगर 29 तारीख तक फाइल करते हैं और अप्रैल में 30 तारीख तक, और लेट फी वेव अगेन सेम डेट्स 29 और 30 तारीख, और मई की अगर आप 3B की ड्यू डेट देखेंगे तो 12 और 14 जुलाई, मतलब 20 दिन का आपको रिलीफ दिया गया। और अगेन GSTR 1 इज सेम बिकॉज इट इज मोर देन 1.5 करोड़। देन वी कम टू टर्नओवर अप टू 1.5 करोड़, तो यहाँ पे 3B में अगेन डेट्स अलग अलग हैं। फेब्रवरी का अगर आप 30 जून तक फाइल कर देंगे तो नो इंटरेस्ट, मार्च का 3 जुलाई, अप्रैल का 6 जुलाई, बट इन केस ऑफ मई इट इज 12 जुलाई एंड 14th ऑफ जुलाई। एंड GSTR 1 की हम बात करें तो जनवरी से मार्च का मेरे को GSTR 1 फाइल करना है 30th ऑफ अप्रैल, सो दैट डेट हैज नॉट बीन एक्सटेंडेड, बट लेट फीस का बेनिफिट है कि वो 30 जून तक भी फाइल करेंगे तो भी चले, पर अप्रैल से लेकर जून के बारे में कोई भी बात नहीं करेंगे। तो स्पेसिफिकली जो नोटिफिकेशंस आए हैं वो आए हैं 3B के लिए, 1 के लिए, पर इन सारे रिटर्न्स के बारे में कोई बात नहीं करी गई है। बट अगेन इन रिटर्न्स के लिए भी ड्यू डेट जो एक जनरल नोटिफिकेशन आया 35/2020, जो एक जनरल जितने भी कंप्लाइंसेस हैं जो इस ड्यू डेट्स के अंदर फॉल करते हैं 20 मार्च से लेकर 29 जून, तो उनकी डेट 30 जून कर दी गई, तो उसमें भी ये सारे फॉलो करेंगे, सारे इंक्लूड होंगे विद GSTR 7, 8, 5 एंड GSTR 6, तो इनकी भी ड्यू डेट बढ़ाई है। ड्यू डेट इसका मतलब मेरे को इंटरेस्ट और लेट फी का कोई भी कंडीशन फुलफिल नहीं कर। और इस बीच में मार्च अप्रैल एंड मई 3 रिटर्न्स आते हैं। सो नाउ वी टॉक अबाउट एक्सटेंशन इन वेरियस कंप्लाइंसेज। अभी हम बात कर रहे थे 3B की, 1 की, उसके अलावा भी बहुत सारे कंप्लाइंसेज होते हैं। सपोज अगर आपके पास कोई ऑडिट का नोटिस आ गया है कि आप 15 दिन के अंदर हमें डॉक्यूमेंट जमा करें, हम आपके ऑडिट करना चाहते हैं, आपका रजिस्ट्रेशन कैंसिल का नोटिस आ गया है या उसका ऑर्डर ही आ चुका है, या कोई भी आपका असेसमेंट का ऑर्डर आ गया है, या आपके कोई शोकॉज या डिमांड नोटिस इशू हो गया है, तो उस केस में अगर कोई स्पेसिफाइड टाइमलाइंस हैं तो उन्होंने उसमें क्या कहा है, वेयर एनी टाइमलाइन टाइम लिमिट फॉर कंप्लीशन और कंप्लायंस ऑफ एनी एक्शन बाय एनी अथॉरिटी और बाय एनी पर्सन व्हिच फॉल्स ड्यूरिंग द पीरियड फ्रॉम द 20th ऑफ मार्च से लेकर 29th ऑफ जून, देन सच टाइम लिमिट शैल बी एक्सटेंडेड टू 30th ऑफ जून तक, उसको एक्सटेंड कर दिया गया। और उसके इंक्लूजन क्या है, फ्रॉम पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट के लिए भी उसको इंक्लूजन किया गया कि डिपार्टमेंट भी चाहे तो अगर डिपार्टमेंट के एंगल से अगर कोई टाइमलाइन है, जैसे कि रजिस्ट्रेशन की टाइमलाइंस होती हैं, बहुत सारे कैंसिलेशन में टाइमलाइंस होती है, विद इन 7 डेज में डिपार्टमेंट को रिवर्ट करना है, रिफंड क्लेम्स की टाइमलाइंस होती है, विद इन 15 डेज में उनको एक्नॉलेजमेंट इशू करना होता है। तो उस एंगल से भी, फ्रॉम पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट भी, उनको वो बेनिफिट दिया गया अगर वो ड्यू डेट है 20 मार्च से लेकर 25 जून। एंड फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ टैक्स पेयर, ऑफकोर्स फॉर फाइलिंग ऑफ एनी अपील, रिप्लाई, एप्लीकेशन, रिपोर्ट, डॉक्यूमेंट, वट एवर। पर इसके सर कुछ एक्सक्लूजन भी हैं, एक्सक्लूजन इन द सेंस जिसपे ये रूल अप्लाई नहीं करेगा, बेनिफिट नहीं मिलेगा। सर वहां पे आते हैं कुछ प्रोविजन हैविंग नो टाइमलाइन, जिसका कोई एसच लीगल टर्मिनोलॉजी नहीं, सिर्फ वो एक तरह से बिजनेस सिचुएशंस है। लीगल टाइम एंड वैल्यू ऑफ सप्लाई, देयर इज नो चेंज। टैक्स इनवॉइस मेरे को वही विद इन 30 डेज और विद इन 45 डेज का जो टाइम है मेरे को इश्यू करना है इन केस ऑफ सर्विसेज। ट्रेड फ्रेंडली प्रोविजन है जीएसटी रजिस्ट्रेशन के, अगेन ओनली फॉर जीएसटी रजिस्ट्रेशन। तो अगर आज मैं जीएसटी रजिस्ट्रेशन के लिए अप्लाई करूंगा तो मेरे को विद इन 3 डेज में रजिस्ट्रेशन अलाउड हो जाना चाहिए। अगर कोई क्वेरी नहीं आती तो उसके अंदर कोई भी रिलीफ नहीं दिया गया, तो दिस इज एक्चुअली बेनिफिशियल। कुछ सीरियस ऑफेंसेस होते हैं जहाँ पे आप कोई फ्रॉड करते हैं, इन केस ऑफ लेट से इफ यू आर फेक आईटीसी, क्लेमिंग आईटीसी विदाउट इनवॉइसिंग, क्लेमिंग आईटीसी ऑन इनवॉइस विदाउट सप्लाई। तो दे आर डिफरेंट कपल ऑफ सीरियस ऑफेंसेस जिसको गवर्नमेंट को लगता है कि हम उस पर कोई रिलैक्सेशन नहीं देना चाहते हैं, तो उस केस में भी देर इज नो एक्सटेंशन। तो अरेस्ट भी हो सकता है, आपकी पेनल्टी भी लग सकती है अंडर सेक्शन 122 में जो भी सिचुएशंस कवर थी, एंड डिटेंशन एंड सीजर ड्यूरिंग ट्रांजिट भी हो सकता है। तो अगर आपकी गाड़ी चलेगी लॉकडाउन के बाद, अगर वो गुड्स इन ट्रांजिट में है, तो उसके बाद वैलिड ईवी बिल होना चाहिए, अदरवाइज दे हैव ए पावर टू डिटेन इट ड्यूरिंग ट्रांजिट। तो अगर एग्जाम्पल्स की बात करें, कौन कौन से सिनेरियोस यहाँ पे कवर हो जाते हैं, तो कैंसिलेशन एंड रिवोकेशन ऑफ रजिस्ट्रेशन का पूरा प्रोसेस है वो कवर हो जाएगा। 51 की ड्यू डेट दे रखी है फॉर दोस टैक्स पेयर्स हैविंग टेक्निकल इश्यूज, तो उस केस में 51 की ड्यू डेट दे रखी है तो वो भी इसमें कवर हो जाते हैं। जो ड्यू डेट दे रखी है 31 मार्च 2020, तो वो भी एक्सटेंड हो जाएगी 30 जून 2020। जो 180 डेज वाला रूल है आईटीसी रिवर्सल का, अगर मेरा जो 180 डेज फॉल कर रहे हैं इन बिटवीन दीज 2 डेज, 20 मार्च एंड 29 जून, तो उसमें क्लासिफाई हो जाएगा। कोई भी मेरे पास कोई समन आया है 70 में, जिसमें मेरे को कहा गया कि आप पर्सनली अपियर हो या कोई आप डॉक्यूमेंट सबमिट करें विद इन दी 7 डेज, 14 डेज और 20 डेज, तो आप वहां पे इस नोटिफिकेशन का हवाला देकर टाइम ले सकते हैं। जॉब वर्क के अंदर एक टाइमलाइन होती है कि अगर मैं कोई भी गुड्स मेरे जॉब वर्क के लिए बाहर जा रहे हैं फ्रॉम द फैक्ट्री और प्रीमाइसेस, इन केस ऑफ इनपुट्स 1 साल में वापस आ जाने चाहिए, इन केस ऑफ कैपिटल गुड्स 3 साल में आ जाने चाहिए। अगर वो टाइमलाइन आपके उसमें अगेन फॉल कर रही, तो आपको इसका बेनिफिट उठा लेना चाहिए। एंड रिफंड ऑफ जीएसटी अगेन विद इन 2 ईयर्स फ्रॉम द रिलेवेंट डेट आई कैन क्लेम रिफंड अंडर द जीएसटी। तो अगर वो मेरा ड्यू डेट फॉल कर रहा है बिटवीन दीज, तो आई कैन क्लेम द बेनिफिट ऑफ दिस नोटिफिकेशन। और स्पेशली रिफंड पे उन्होंने ऑलरेडी सर्कुलर के थ्रू उसको क्लेरिफाई भी कर दिया बाई 137 डेट 30। सो दैट्स ऑल अबाउट द एग्जिस्टिंग रिटर्न। सो नाउ वी विल लुक एट ब्रीफ ऑन अ न्यू रिटर्न रिजिम। सो यू नो द 3B इज ओनली अ टेम्पररी मेजर, इट हैज टू गो सम बिकॉज इट हैज इट्स ओन फ्लॉज। उसका एक तो कोई भी इंटरलिंकिंग नहीं है GSTR 1 से, GSTR 2 से कोई इंटरलिंकिंग नहीं है। तो नाउ वी हैव टू कीप डूइंग द रिकंसिलेशन एक्सरसाइजेस ऑन ए मैनुअल बेसिस, जो दिस वॉज नॉट एक्चुअली द इंटेंशन ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट, और द जो आइडियल स्ट्रक्चर आया था 1, 2 और 3 का, सो दैट वॉज नॉट द इंटेंशन। तो सिंस GSTR 3 भी चलता चला गया, 3 साल हो गए, सो नाउ इट हैज टू गो। एंड नए रिटर्न सूनर और लेटर, ऑल दो इट्स की जो डेट्स है जिसका इम्प्लीमेंटेशन है, शायद बीन एक्सटेंडेड टिल 1st ऑफ अक्टूबर, पर ये हो सकता है आगे भी बढ़ जाए, पर अल्टीमेटली इट विल कम। एंड जीएसटी पोर्टल पे ऑलरेडी उसका जो प्रोटोटाइप है, जो टेस्टिंग मॉडल है, वो ऑलरेडी अवेलेबल है। मीन GSTN इज ऑलरेडी रेडी विद द एंटायर स्कीमा ऑफ न्यू रिटर्न्स। सो व्हाई दिस इज इम्पॉर्टेंट एंड रिलेवेंट नाउ, बिकॉज सर क्या है कि इसमें ऐसे कुछ एडिशनल रिपोर्टिंग रिक्वायरमेंट्स भी रहेंगी जो आपको फॉलो करनी है। तो उस एडिशनल रिपोर्टिंग रिक्वायरमेंट्स ऑन ए एडवांस बेसिस आप अपने बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट में, आप अपने अकाउंटिंग सिस्टम में पहले से उसको कैप्चर कर लें, सो दैट यू नीड नॉट फॉल इनटू एनी हैजल्स लेटर ऑन जब ये आता है. टू गिव यू एन एग्जांपल, इनपुट सर्विस और कैपिटल गुड्स का जो क्रेडिट है, जिसका आज तक कोई भी बाइफर्केशन आपसे 3B में नहीं मांगा गया है, उसका बाइफर्केशन आपसे 9 में मांगा गया था, जिसको उन्होंने ऑप्शनल कर दिया था, पर नए रिटर्न्स के अंदर उसका आपको अलग से बाइफर्केशन देना पड़ेगा. देन देयर कपल ऑफ लाइक रिवर्स चार्ज. इन रिवर्स चार्ज में उन्होंने कंप्लीट डेज शिफ्ट, तो रिवर्स चार्ज में व्हाट दे मेंशन की सप्लायर इन दोस ट्रांजेक्शन जहाँ पर रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म अप्लाई होता है, सो नॉट सप्लायर्स बट द रिसिपिएंट विल हैव टू रिपोर्ट दोस ट्रांजेक्शन और आइदर ऑन पैन वाइज और GSTN वाइज. मीन्स या तो फॉर ईच GSTN से आप जो भी सर्विसेज अवेल करते हैं जिस पर आपको रिवर्स चार्ज अप्लाई करना है, सो नाउ इट ऑल्सो इंक्लूड्स इम्पोर्ट्स एंड इम्पोर्ट ऑफ सर्विसेज. फॉर इम्पोर्ट्स ऑफ गुड्स तो आपको बिल ऑफ एंट्री वाइज उसमें डालना पड़ेगा. टिल द टाइम इवन इनका ये भी प्लान है कि ये कस्टम्स का जो पोर्टल है, जो आइस गेट का पोर्टल है, उसको इसको इंटरलिंक करती है. अल्टीमेटली द टाइम्स टू कम जो कस्टम्स पे जो भी आप डेटा आपका अवेलेबल है इन केस ऑफ इम्पोर्ट्स वो ऑटोमेटिकली ऑटो पॉपुलेट होगा रिटर्न्स के पोर्टल में. पर सिंस दिस फैसिलिटी इज नॉट अवेलेबल, सो ड्यूरिंग द इंटरिम पीरियड आपको मैनुअली इम्पोर्ट ऑफ गुड्स का भी ट्रांजेक्शन उसमें इनवॉइस वाइज डालना पड़ेगा. तो अगेन इट इज एन एडिशनल रिपोर्टिंग रिक्वायर्ड. तो सर कौन सा रिटर्न क्या हो जाएगा? GSTR 1 आज हम फाइल करते हैं तो नाउ इट विल बी शिफ्टेड टू ANX 1. पहले अगर स्कीम की बात करें तो यहाँ पे जो मेरा मेन रिटर्न होगा दैट विल बी GST RET 1. RET 1 इज माय मेन रिटर्न और उसके दो बकेट्स होंगे, वन इज ANX 1 एंड अनदर इज ANX 2. तो ANX 1 इज द सप्लाई रिटर्न अगेंस्ट सेल्स एंड ANX 2 इज योर परचेस रिटर्न. पर यहाँ पे ANX 1 का इसको बढ़ा दिया गया है. ANX 1 इज नॉट ओनली सप्लाई रिटर्न, इट इंक्लूड्स ऑल दोस ट्रांजेक्शन जहाँ पे आपकी liability है, so including reverse charge भी आपको ANX 1 के अंदर report करना है जहाँ पे भी आपको GST pay करना है. And ANX 2 is on the similar lines we had GSTR 2, तो जहाँ पे आपको action लेना है, you have to keep taking action and you have to ticking, so that is ANX 2. Then GSTR 3 और 3B जो है वो RET 1 मिल जाएगा. And we have 2 or 3 also. उसके अलावा वन इम्पॉर्टेंट आस्पेक्ट, यहाँ पे आपको अमेंडमेंट का भी ऑप्शन दिया गया है. यू कैन अमेंड द रिटर्न, सो 1 कैन बी अमेंडेड बाय 1A एंड RET 1 कैन आल्सो बी अमेंडेड बाय 1A, बट ANX 2 कैन नॉट बी अमेंडेड बिकॉज़ दिस ओनली एक्शन टेकिंग रिटर्न, इट इज नॉट एक्चुअली यू कैन नॉट यू नो अपलोड एनीथिंग. तो अगर यहाँ स्ट्रक्चर की बात करें तो एग्रीगेट टर्नओवर इन प्रीवियस फाइनेंशियल ईयर मोर देन 5 करोड़ मंथली रिटर्न आपको फाइल करना है. RET 1 यू हैव टू फाइल मैंडेटरी. तो यहाँ पे आप देख रहे हैं कि 1.5 करोड़ की अभी लिमिट होती थी करंटली GSTR 1 के लिए, वो इन्होंने इसको शिफ्ट कर दिया 5 करोड़ तक. एंड एग्रीगेट टर्नओवर अप टू 5 करोड़ में आपके पास ऑप्शन है 3 रिटर्न के. ये सर 3 ऑप्शन दिए गए क्वार्टरली रिटर्न में. पहला RET 1 फाइल कर सकते हैं, सेकेंड RET 2 फाइल कर सकते हैं ओनली इफ यू हैव B2C एंड RCM सप्लायर. सिर्फ B2C, अगर आप एक नॉर्मल जनरल स्टोर है, आपका आप रिटेलर हैं और आपका एंटायर जो कस्टमर चेन है दैट इज अनरजिस्टर्ड इन GST, तो वहां पे आप B2C में RET 2 फाइल कर सकते हैं. एंड RET 3 इज देयर जहाँ पे आपका सिर्फ B2B, B2C एंड RCM सप्लाईज है, मीन्स ओनली डोमेस्टिक ट्रांजेक्शन. अगर आपका एक भी एक्सपोर्ट का ट्रांजेक्शन हुआ तो आपको शिफ्ट होना पड़ेगा RET 1 के अंदर. तो जैसा कि हमने देखा कि RET 1 चाहे RET 1 है, चाहे RET 2 है, चाहे RET 3 है, तीनों के दो एनेक्सर्स हैं, ANX 1 एंड ANX 2. सो आउटवर्ड सप्लाई एंड इनवर्ड सप्लाई अंडर RCM यू हैव टू फाइल. ANX 2 में इनवर्ड सप्लाई इज बेस्ड ऑन ऑटो पॉपुलेशन आफ्टर अपलोडिंग ऑफ डेटा इन GSTR 1, जिसमें मेरे को एक्शन लेना. उसके अलावा अदर रिटर्न है GST PMT 08. तो नाउ जब हम यहाँ बात कर रहे थे RET 2 और RET 3 की, सर जब ये कह रहे हैं कि आपको क्वार्टरली रिटर्न फाइल करना है, RET 1 में कह रहे हैं क्वार्टरली रिटर्न फाइल करना है, पर क्या ये टैक्स पेमेंट भी क्वार्टरली होगा? नहीं सर, टैक्स पेमेंट मंथली कराने के लिए ये एक रिटर्न लेके आए GST PMT 08, जिसमें क्या होगा, और टैक्स पेमेंट फॉर फर्स्ट 2 मंथ्स आपको टैक्स पेमेंट इससे करना पड़ेगा जहां पे आप क्वार्टरली रिटर्न फाइल करते हैं। और फिर तो जनवरी से मार्च का अगर मान लो क्वार्टर है, तो जनवरी और फरवरी में आप जीएसटी पीएमटी 08 फाइल करेंगे, और मार्च में फिर आप आरटी 1, 2 या 3 फाइल करेंगे, और उसी टाइम पे आप एनएक्स 1, 2 फाइल करेंगे, और पीएमटी 08 का जो भी डेटा है वो उसमें ऑटो पॉपुलेट होकर आता है। एंड दीज ऑल आर द अमेंडमेंट रिटर्न्स। सो थैंक यू वेरी मच, दैट्स ऑल फ्रॉम माय साइड। सो वी कैन टेक अप क्वेश्चंस इफ आई थिंक फ्यू आर फेसिंग इश्यूज इन स्लाइड विजिबिलिटी, बट आई एम नॉट श्योर व्हाई इट वाज देयर, बिकॉज़ हियर इट्स शोइंग दैट आई कैन सी द स्क्रीन राइट। So, if you take up any questions, are there any ways where we can check out our 2A credit on real time on? Yes, sir. उसमें क्या होता है सर, आपके पास कुछ सॉफ्टवेयर्स अवेलेबल होते हैं, जैसे क्लियर टेक्स है, वेबटेल है, वो आपको फैसिलिटी प्रोवाइड करते हैं कि एक्सेल में आप पूरे साल का डेटा डाउनलोड कर सकते हैं रियल टाइम बेसिस पे, और वहां से आप कर सकते हैं। ऑल दो जीएसटी पोर्टल पे आपके पास ये अवेलेबल नहीं होगा। If invoice raised in March 19 and goods received in April 19, what will happen in such case? Sir, ऐसा है सर, जो ITC claim करने की जो conditions हैं, तो ITC claim करने की जो conditions हैं, उसमें one of the conditions that goods should be received by. तो अगर आपके पास goods नहीं आए, तो आप ITC नहीं claim कर सकते। उस केस में आपको अप्रैल 19 में ही ITC claim करना पड़ेगा। What are the consequences if it is not shown that sale is through e-commerce, the liability is correctly shown? Sir, although this is only merely procedural lapse, अगर आपने टैक्स पेमेंट सही किया है, so this is only clerical lapse, और इस पर कोई मेजर कॉम्प्लिकेशंस नहीं होगा। So thank you very much, Virag जी, if you are there, so over to you.
थैंक यू सो मच निखिल जी। एम आई ऑडिबल निखिल जी?
हाँ जी विराग जी, यस।
या सो इट्स अ वेरी नाइस वंडरफुल डिटेल प्रेजेंटेशन एंड इंक्लूसिव प्रेजेंटेशन वुड लाइक टू से। वी आर वेरी
राइट,
थैंकफुल टू यू एंड वी हैव एडेड यू इन अ ग्रुप ऑल्सो। सो एनी क्वेरी प्लीज पोस्ट देयर एंड निखिल जी विल श्योरली आंसर दैट एज पर हिज कन्वीनियंस। सो थैंक यू ऑल ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स। वी आर एंडिंग वेबिनार नाउ हियर। थैंक यू।
ओके।